welcome to this episode of Life with Lizzie. I am your host, Lizzie. Today, we have AJ Cortez with us. AJ is a research associate at the Paulson Institute. Thank you so much for joining me, AJ.
Thanks for having me, Lizzie. Great to be with you.
So, AJ, you recently published a research analyzing the collaboration competition between U.S. and Chinese AI talent. Can you sort of walk us through the research procedure? How did you begin your investigation and what are the main takeaways?
Sure. Thanks, Lizzie. So at MacroPolo, which is the Paulson Institute's think tank, we've actually been looking at AI talent between the US and China going back a few years with the release of our AI Global Talent Tracker, which is one of our digital projects, which kind of looked at the flow of top tier AI researchers between the US, China, and other countries, you know, where they get their degrees and where they end up staying and working. And so this is something we had some foundation in. And I think when the arrival of generative AI products like ChatGPT really went viral at the end of last year and early this year with GPT-4. We knew that there was a lot of excitement on both sides of the Pacific from US tech companies and Chinese tech companies alike, all trying to get in and release really impressive AI products. And so at that point, we kind of knew that talent was the most determining factor of whether these efforts would kind of be successful. And so we decided to kind of take a deeper look at what the talent landscape looks like in AI. And specifically in this report, we looked at the talent at OpenAI and GPT-4.
Fantastic. In the report, you also highlight the role of MSRA, Microsoft Research Asia, as a talent incubator for both US and China. I wonder if you can elaborate that example a little bit more. What are the factors contributing to MSRA's success in fostering AI talents?
Sure. So the example of Microsoft Research Asia is really an interesting one because, first of all, it started back in 1998, 1999. And so it was a very different geopolitical landscape at that time. You know, American companies wanted access to the Chinese market and they were expanding there not only in their operations, but also in research centers. So Microsoft Research Asia was Microsoft's first overseas R&D center. And today I believe it is also its largest. And so what this allowed Microsoft to do was to leverage some of its leading research and resources in AI and really tap into a reserve of Chinese talents. And so some of the best Chinese technical engineers and computer scientists in the 90s and early 2000s would end up at Microsoft Research Asia, where they would really hone their skills and progress and contribute to not only research in the field, but many of them would go on to make contributions in the private sector, either at top Western tech firms or increasingly leading technical teams at tech companies in China as well.
Fantastic. So your research also talk about synergies between US and Chinese AI talents. I wonder if you can share with us some specific examples of collaborations between the United States and China that have led to significant advancement in the technology.
Sure. And so just to touch on kind of this flow of talent between Microsoft Research Asia and the US and China, you know, there were significant executives in the Chinese tech space that were a result of Microsoft Research Asia. So I'm referring to, for example, one of Baidu's chief scientists, Jingdong Wang, as well as Weiying Ma, who went on to ByteDance's AI lab after 15 years at Microsoft Research Asia. We also have Lenovo's chief technology officer, was a decade-long veteran at Microsoft Research Asia, as well as some of the chief scientists at Megvii as well, the Chinese computer vision company. So I think it's important to know that these talent links exist both in the private sector and in the research realm. When it comes to research between the US and China, Microsoft Research Asia has made some significant contributions to the field overall, the most consequential of which probably came in 2015, when a team from Microsoft Research Asia kind of blew away the competition at the global image recognition competition called ImageNet. And so that performance came from a crucial breakthrough in deep learning network architecture called ResNet. And so this ResNet paper was really hugely consequential in the deep learning and AI field. And the authors of that ResNet paper went on to really bigger careers in AI, one of which went on to actually found Megvii. So these talent pipelines between the US and China really helped to augment the overall research environment around AI and really helped commercialize a lot of key technologies in the field.
Fantastic. Your research also indicates a super interesting phenomenon, which is this talent flow between United States and China. Many Chinese scientists are educated in the United States, and they stay on in the U.S. to continue their career and research. But there seems to be this decline in Chinese students pursuing computer science and math degrees in the United States in the past few years. Can you sort of elaborate on that a little more? How do you envision the future of AI talent migration between the United States? As you know, both governments seems to be trying its best to attract global talents.
Sure. So that general decline in the number of Chinese students in computer science and mathematics courses in the U.S. is actually more from the impact of pandemic-related travel restrictions over the last couple of years. If you look at some of the underlying data, it's actually more encouraging because a greater proportion of Chinese students that come to the U.S. are actually enrolling in computer science and mathematics courses. So while there was an overall decline in the volume over the last couple of years, the proportion of Chinese students interested in these AI-relevant disciplines is actually increasing. So that means that as the overall trend recovers from the post-pandemic impact, we're hoping to see that the U.S. will continue to attract a growing number of Chinese computer science and math talents. And this is important because as something in our global AI data tracker shows, kind of one of the key elements of a successful AI career is actually a graduate degree from a U.S. university. So that's something that a lot of our data has shown. And also, over close to 90% of Chinese computer science graduate students who complete their degree in the U.S. end up staying and working in the U.S. So that's obviously a significant competitive advantage in the talent competition for the United States. That being said, we are also becoming more reliant on foreign STEM talent. So, for example, if the United States did not have any foreign STEM talent, it would only have 20,000 STEM PhDs as of 2019, which is less than half the number in China. But thanks to the inflow of highly skilled foreign talent, we see that the US is actually able to graduate closer to 33,000 STEM PhDs. So that's a large percentage coming from foreign-born workers. And that actually bears out in some other immigration data that we've seen where STEM workers in the United States, foreign-born STEM workers are more likely to hold a graduate degree than their US-born counterparts. So it's not just that these talents are really coming in and making a difference, but they're really making a difference at the top end of the spectrum. And the premium talent category, which is obviously crucial to AI development itself.
I also wanted to turn to regulations a little bit. How would you describe the differences in regulatory landscapes between the United States and China? How do those variations influence the direction and focus of AI research and development in China and US respectively?
Sure. So there are different regulatory landscapes, but it's also important to understand that the regulation isn't always up to date with the technology. So I think we're still in the midst of an evolving landscape where governments are trying to really get a handle on the implications for these technologies. That being said, I think that Chinese regulators are much more aware to the potential risks of this technology. You know, we've seen in the generative AI frenzy recently that Chinese regulators were calling for caution in how they wanted to release these products. And I think this really is an interesting dynamic in that OpenAI just sort of released ChatGPT and is now iterating and gathering all this user data and feedback to further train its programs. Whereas Chinese equivalents, like maybe if it's Baidu or SenseTime or other companies, they've had to really be a little more careful in their rollout of these products, given the potential for generative AI chatbots to output to be potentially politically sensitive. I think that could be understood to be an unsurprising reality, but I think that these regulatory standards are obviously going to have to try and evolve to keep pace with the technology. But for now, it seems that China is taking a more cautious approach with more guardrails when it comes to generative AI technology. Going forward in more broader scope of AI, I think we might see that Chinese companies and regulators and researchers might be a little more inclined to embrace enterprise-facing solutions, which are perhaps less high profile and have less public-facing consumer implications to the wider society. So that means integrating AI into industrial applications to increase efficiency. We've seen that. Whereas perhaps some of the Western tech might be more focused on consumer applications. So again, these are just preliminary observations, and the regulatory landscape will continue to shift. I think the United States is certainly going to need to get a handle on that. We've seen some constituents calling for a pause on AI research. And so I think this will be a continuing question down the road for sure.
Fantastic. And finally, let's talk about money investment. In terms of funding, how do public and private investment strategies differ in the United States and in China? And what are some of the long-term implications of those differences on AI development?
Sure. So funding is obviously very important, but I don't think we're necessarily seeing the bifurcation of a U.S. camp and a Chinese camp that many might think. In fact, we're seeing that investors are truly global and multinational investors, and they're looking for quality AI projects wherever they may be. We've seen that because there are significant U.S. investments in Chinese AI startups and vice versa. So I think it's important to understand that the investment links in this area are fairly intertwined. When it comes to public versus private, I would go back to kind of what I mentioned in terms of state capital might be a little more inclined to go with enterprise-facing solutions, whereas private capital might embrace consumer applications a bit more. But at the same time, I think we're seeing that Chinese regulators have had AI on their radar for some time now. I think these recent advances are only going to increase that priority and encourage them to devote more resources to not only understanding the technology and legislating accordingly, but also to how to implement it most effectively, given China's economic strengths in areas like, say, advanced manufacturing. So I think that's really something to look out for. And I think that's something that global investors are aware of, and how AI can augment each country's respective strengths.